Hello, everyone. Welcome to our SSI speaker series, Perception is Reality. My name is Carolina Triana, and I'm the Arts and Culture Coordinator here at SSI. I would like to begin by paying my respects to the past and present elders of the Gallican Nation and acknowledge their custodianship of the land on which we're meeting today. I also would like to let you know that we are recording this event and we're streaming live on the internet. You can also follow us as we go on Twitter using the hashtag SSI Speaker Series. To commence the evening, I would like to introduce our CEO, Violet Roumeliotis, who will say a few words before we start. Thank you, Violet.
Thanks, Carolina. On behalf of everyone here this evening, I would also like to acknowledge the traditional custodians of the land of which we're meeting, the Gadigal people of the Eora Nation, and also pay my respects to elders past and present and any Aboriginal people here this evening. Well, we are here tonight for the third event of the SSI Speaker Series, and it's an initiative aimed at helping to create greater understanding and awareness on issues impacting refugees and asylum seekers living in our community. And in recent years, we've seen a hardening of views, particularly towards asylum seekers. And the existence of these negative views has resulted in refugees and asylum seekers experiencing discrimination, isolation, a feeling of not feeling safe in their own community, living in fear. So SSI is committed to understanding public opinion and undertaking initiatives to influence and try and change perceptions. We know firsthand from the work that we do what positive contributions that refugees and asylum seekers make to the community. I'm sure all of you witnessed that as well. So addressing misinformation and prejudice is at the core of what SSI does. From telling client stories to the public, to promoting awareness of the issues through our community engagement programs. But I guess to be able to change these negative perceptions towards refugees and asylum seekers, we need to understand how they are formed. So, to what extent are these negative views shaped by political discourse, by the media, or by our own values as Australians? I guess important questions that we have to ask ourselves. So the panel tonight will approach this complex question from very different perspectives. So I'd like to take this opportunity to thank the panel very much and the facilitator who are joining us tonight. We are grateful to have such a wonderful, distinguished group of experts in their field this evening. And on behalf of SSI, thank you very much to all of you for coming, for braving the rain, when what that's like. I hope you enjoy the evening, and I hope that you do leave the room with a greater understanding of this important issue. So thank you very much, and I'll hand back to Carolina.
I now would like to introduce our facilitator for tonight, who's Oliver Loughlin. Oliver is a journalist with Guardian Australian, specialising in asylum and immigration reporting. He was previously a commissioning editor with the Guardian Common Desk in the UK and worked as a freelance investigative reporter before that. Thank you, Oliver, for joining us tonight and all the speakers today in the panel. Please welcome Oliver Loughlin.
Hello, good evening, thanks very much for coming. So the discussion topic for today is entitled Perception is Reality, How Do We Form Our Perception of Refugees and Asylum Seekers? Now this is a question that I engage with on a daily basis because, as Carolina mentioned, I do reporting on these issues for Guardian Australia. So I've been here for about a year and a half. I came over from England, and in that time I've covered some of the sort of big events that have happened in this field. So the violent unrest on Manus that left Reza Barati dead, the case of the 157 Tamil asylum seekers who were detained on board a customs vessel for 4 weeks. We've looked at the conditions on Christmas Island, particularly with a view to the sort of medical provision that's there. And obviously I've covered the kids in detention national inquiry that's going on at the moment. So what I'm sort of often faced with on a daily basis is the increasingly hardline solutions that the both this government and the previous government have come up with to deal with the issue. And what exists in Australia is a pretty unique policy setting. We've got mandatory officer resettlement, we turn boats back, there's the introduction or the attempted introduction of temporary protection visas, and the elongated incarceration of children across the detention network. So whilst there is a sort of hardline policy, there's also, from my understanding at least, a pretty hardline attitude in the public, so to speak. And I think some of that is going to come out in the research that we're going to hear about today. So in terms of the question of the debate that we're talking about, because I've been here for such a short time, I've never really been able to understand it, to be totally honest. It's a thing that I constantly try and think about, you know, when I'm writing about these issues. How do I do it in a way that is going to engage more people and sort of make them see the reality of what's going on here? And there seems to me to be a sort of interesting, I wouldn't say contradiction, well perhaps it is a contradiction, where you know, you've got on the one hand this very sort of hardline regime versus the rhetoric that comes out of both this government and the previous government, which is all about the humanitarian purpose of saving lives at sea. And only last week that was a sort of key argument that Scott Morrison was putting forward when he was giving evidence at the kids in detention inquiry. Many of these contradictions in the area of this public discourse seem to have been exposed in the research. I don't want to talk about it too much, but there was an interesting statistic that came out in the report that I've just read, that's 84% of Australians who were surveyed in the 2013 survey believe that multiculturalism has been good for Australia, but just 18% of Australians think asylum seekers who arrive by boat should be allowed to apply for permanent residence. So one of the very interesting details as well about the report is just the level of detail that it goes into. It's been able to stratify the places in the world that Australians favour their migration coming from, what sort of labour they're looking for. And also the changes over time. So this is the seventh national survey that's been published in this area. So with that, I will introduce the keynote speaker today, who's Professor Andrew Markus. Andrew Markus is the Pratt Foundation Research Professor of Jewish Civilization at Monash University and is a fellow of the Academy of Social Sciences in Australia. He's published extensively on Australian immigration and race relations and heads the Scanlon Foundation's Social Cohesion Research Programme, which, as we know, is what we're going to be talking about today. So please join me in welcoming to the stage.
Thank you for that introduction. Good evening, everybody. I also pay my respects to the traditional owners, their elders past and present, coming to the nation. I also want to pay my respects to you, because I think that your the work that you do is vital to some sort of balance in our society. I think you are not doing the work that you're doing. I'm assuming that quite a number of you actually work in this space, with helping people who desperately do need help. What would happen to the balance of our society? I should also acknowledge that I came to this country as a refugee in 1957, a refugee from Hungary, and we were resettled here. We were basically penniless and had a wonderful opportunity in this country. All right, I've actually gone on a journey, because back in 2000 or thereabouts, I was a very harsh critic of government policies. We ran a seminar at Monash University on bridging fees for the fours, you know, which let people in the community get basically pennies. And all the harsh policies. And what I've been trying to do is to, I guess why we're here all of us today, is to try to understand Australian public opinion. And that's what I'm going to try to unpack here. And I think because of the support of the foundation, the Scanlon Foundation, and we've now done seven national surveys, and provided time for me to research, we probably better understand attitudes in Australia than most of any other country. Like, if you want to do Google to see what are attitudes in the EU to asylum seekers, you're not necessarily going to find a lot. I tried the other day and I couldn't find very much. And hopefully what we've got on our side And these are like the annual reports that we publish every year. And if you want to read all this information, it's on the site. It's called Mapping Australia's Population at Monash. And hopefully we're in a position to better understand these issues. Because at the end of the day, we all want to be in a position where we're basing what we do on a factual basis, rather than necessarily some of the prejudices that you find on the other side of the community. All right, so I'm going to talk a bit about, and I'm talking for about 20 minutes, and if I'm going too long, just speak pleasantly. Talk a bit about the surveys, talk about interpreting public opinion, people's perceptions of asylum seekers, then public opinion on humanitarian program and arrivals by boat. Because you've got to do both. You've got to understand what Australians think about humanitarian program and what they think about arrivals by boat. And they're actually two quite separate issues. And then even the segments of the population, when we look at subgroups in the population, it's important to look at subgroups because that's what gives you predictive value. If you've just got flat data, you don't know where that's heading other than maybe you can compare it in the past. But you've got to look at segments in the population. For example, what do 25-year-old Australian university students think? Okay, so let's get to that point where we can actually understand that. So you might assume that they're very critical in the Australian government policy. All right, so the Scanlon surveys have been running since 2007, and since 2009 they've been annual. In addition, we've done local area surveys. We've done a survey of third-plus generation Australian-born, which we're going to release in October this year. We've done new arrivals. We have large samples, a total database of more than 20,000 respondents now. So we can really look at subgroups and see what's going on there. And to get an understanding of what is changing and what is constant. Now, the point I'd make to you is that on many issues, public opinion hardly changes from one year to the next. You know, I've just been looking at some data for this year, and I can get 30.3 one year and get 30.5 the next year. That's that you actually change. So this is just an example. And, you know, Australia's a land of economic opportunity where in the long run you work hard, you get on. 12, 10, 10, 10, 10, 11. And so you look at the various possible answers and hardly changes at all. That's our website, by the way. So Mapping Australia's Population. Now, some people think that you understand public opinion just by looking at the numbers. It's very simple. I can look at a survey. 40%, 60%, whatever. I've been to a seminar where a lawyer working in this space explained what public opinion was. I wouldn't get up and explain to you what humanitarian law is. I don't have the qualifications for that. It's actually very difficult to interpret public opinion. We got our results for this round of surveying well over a month ago, and I'm still looking at tables and trying to decode it. I'm looking for patterns, because the challenge is to find the patterns, because basically the patterns are there. If you haven't got the patterns, you haven't understood what's going on. Does that sort of make sense? Mm-hmm. So, important things you have to take into account. What's the exact wording of the question? How are people going to interpret that question? What's the context in which that question is asked? What was the previous question? What is the mode for administering the survey? Is it a random sample? Was it administered by telephone, face-to-face? Was it administered online on a computer? How good is the sample? And we're just starting to understand, the other things we're exploring now is, what's the difference between someone asking you over the telephone and you completing a survey online? And as I'm reading the data now, it's not a good picture, because we've mainly been using face-to-face interviewing or telephone interviewing. When people do it online, you're actually picking up more negative attitudes. Does that make sense to you? Mm-hmm. You know, you want to sort of please the person you're talking to. And if you ask something, you're not necessarily going to give an extreme view, whereas if you do it online. So the data that I'm presenting to you today is basically telephone data. It's actually probably a little bit worse in terms of levels of negativity when we look at online data. And we'll be reporting that on that. But what I'm saying is, don't just look at one survey, look at many surveys and try to decode and understand the patterns, and it's a difficult process to do that. So the basis of opinion, and you know, often people will say, well, it's the media that drives opinion. I mean, just think about that for a second. Sure, the media drives opinion, but within a narrow band. You know, if I go down to the news agents in the morning, and I don't say, give me the paper, do I? Say, give me the Daily Telegraph. Give me the Sydney Morning Herald. Yes, I don't turn on the TV and not even bother what channel I'm on. Am I watching tabloid television? Am I watching SBS? Or am I watching ABC? So do you understand that it's very trite to say it's the media that drives what we're going on? You know, if I'm going to read The Guardian Australia, I'm going to read that for a purpose. I want to read your articles because you're going to tell me what I want to know, in effect, and reinforce my position. Yep. You're not going to have people X, Y, and Z suddenly clicking on The Guardian Australia and starting reading and not having any background. So I think that this notion that, you know, it's the media that drives it, or if it's the politicians that drive opinion, you know, I think you're missing a lot of the points. You know, if you think that the politicians are driving this as hard as they can, you're way wrong. You're way wrong. You know what would really upset people? If the politicians said how much money was spent last year on the whole range of activities to do with asylum seekers in Australia. Yep. Because the number is actually quite shocking in a way. To give you an indication, it's just a ballpark. Australia probably spends more than the whole of the UNHCR budget. UNHCR budget deals with millions of people. Australia deals with thousands. Now, if the politicians really want to drive this, does it make sense? This is what they would do. You know, I was surprised because I was really critical of the Howard government. Say in 2004, 2005, I'm sure many of you. And then I realised that government was actually maintaining a relatively large humanitarian policy. And where was it taking most of the humanitarian entrance from? Africa, Sudan. So we want to say it's simple prejudice and bigotry. It's actually much more complex than that, and that's what we want to try to understand. And what I'm explaining to you is the journey I went on to try to understand the complexities of this issue. You know, the assumptions that it's a bigoted country, that public opinion is fickle, you know, one day it's here and one day it's there. That it's shaped by the media or political discourse, it's raced to the bottom. The politicians have failed to provide leadership. I think all of these are very, very questionable. Like, we have this myth about the Fraser years. It's not my purpose here to unpack that, but I'm telling you that it's actually largely a myth of the good old Fraser years. The nature of the issues, the nature of the problems were totally different in the Fraser years. When we have a statement like this from the UNHCR, the High Commissioner, and I think it was used to publicise this event, with all respect, I think what he's saying is I haven't got a clue. You know, because he's saying, how is it this country has a very large immigration program, and he's happy with that, and then it has boat arrivals and it goes ballistic. Why is that? I don't understand it. But is it really such a puzzle? You see, where you're comparing elephants and turkeys, you're comparing oranges and pears or whatever, it's not the same, it's very different. If a government is actually, and with the data from this year is showing, if the government is able to convince the public that it is policing the borders, so to speak, levels of tension in the community go down. Like this year, we've had two surveys already issued, which, like the Australian had a survey just a couple of weeks ago, and asked people, what do you think about the current level of immigration? And only 27% of people said it was too high. It should be 60% given the current socioeconomic environment. And it was 27%. So one of the things that the government has achieved by convincing people, very brutally, convincing people that the borders are now being guarded, is actually it's reduced the level of tension around cultural diversity. So we're dealing with complex issues here, that's my argument. When you ask people, like, you know, we're going to educate the public. I say, you're not going to educate the public. People filter information essentially through their value system. Does that make sense to you?
Yeah.
They interpret information according to their value system. And if you convince them you're wrong here, they go to this position here, which is an equivalent position. That's why it's very difficult to deal with prejudice, which is attitudinally based, or and to think that you're going to change it by providing information. What do you think is the main reason asylum seekers try to reach Australia by boat? We asked this for 3 years as an open-ended question in our survey, and then we gave up because there's no much point to it. You know, on the one hand, they're coming for a better life. That's the number one issue. They're coming for a better life. Or they're living in poverty and they want a better life. And you add those and you get about 50% plus. Now, the people actually might at the same time think that the people are in fear of their lives, they're being persecuted and they're desperate. They can hold both views together simultaneously. With me? Yeah, that they're queue jumpers, that they're wealthy and so on. So this whole range of complex mishmash of attitudes goes together. You know, at the end of the day, what do we hear? One is that there's very strong support in Australia for the humanitarian program. Do you feel positive, negative or neutral about refugees who've been assessed overseas and found to be victims of persecution and in need of help coming to live in Australia? And we're getting like 70 or 75% of people over the telephone, probably less online, but nonetheless a clear majority of people saying, yes, I agree with that. That's a real good thing. That's a base, something that you can actually work with, other than I'm going to totally transform your whole outlook on life. I'm going to do it, you read this and you'll be right. All right, so that's really important finding. Now, when we look at arrivals by boat, what we find, and the ballpark figure is only about 20 or 25% of the population, give or take a couple beyond that band, who will agree that if you come by boat, you should be eligible for permanent settlement. It's 20-25%, and it hasn't really changed much in 15 years. Sometimes it goes to the top of that level, like a 27-28, other times it might come down to 17 or 18, but that's the ballpark. Now, this is, in general, which of the following statements best describes your view on how Australia should deal with asylum seekers? And you detain them in camps, allow them to live in the community, that's 2001. In some ways, this is shocking, but it just shows you how embedded those attitudes are, because the Federal Court of Australia has ruled that the government actually acted unlawfully in detaining the refugees on the Tampa and has ordered the boat people on the Tampa be returned to the Australian mainland. 2001. Yes, they should be returned to the mainland, 19%. Hello? You've just been told that the Federal Court of Australia has determined that they have to be returned to the mainland. 19% agree with the highest judicial body in this land. You know, I really question what is gained by going to the High Court. Because government knows that this is the environment. What I've done is, these are all different questions, but I'm trying to make sense of it. Various surveys, and you see the people who, when you ask, turn back boats carrying asylum seekers, and the proportion who disagree, it's around 20-25% in that ballpark. And it doesn't really shift very much. We look at some more recent surveys. August 2012. Do you support the decision to resume offshore processing in Papua New Guinea and Nauru? Opposed 27%. So I got out of my 20-25% range, but not very much. This is another survey. Do you support or disapprove reopening detention facilities in Nauru and Manus Island? 18%. This is from this year. Do you think the federal government is too tough or too soft on asylum seekers, or is it taking the right approach? Too tough, 22%. Too soft, 25%. Too soft. What do you want them to do? We're going to hang people, you know, and save some money by that process. I mean, what do people think? But nonetheless, you see the constant element there. And look at the Liberal National Party supporters. 3%, too tough. But don't dismiss this as simple prejudice or bigotry. It's something we have to understand. We have to try to unpack the contradictions. This is the most recent poll, Lowy. The government should turn back votes when it's safe to do so. Disagree, 28%. Now, this is the question that we've used. We've said, which of the following statements comes closest to your view about the best policy for dealing with asylum seekers trying to reach Australia by boat?
And one option is eligible for resettlement, temporary, lock them up and deport them as soon as you can, or turn back the boats. And again, you see, even though there's some change, you see that the constant element is more apparent than the change. So there has actually been an increase from 23 to 33%, but it's not from 20% to 80%. It's roughly within that sort of ballpark that I'm trying to sort of, that's how I've decoded this. All right, segments of the population. Now this is really very telling, because what I've done here is that, yeah, this is, that's this answer, the permanent answer. Can I find any segment of the population which is significantly outside that band? And yes, I can. It's only one. Greens. I'm going to vote for Greens, 69%. In no other segment of the population do you get above 30%.
All right. So this was in our 213 report, in no other segment. Let's look, for example, at young people, age 18 to 24, just 24%. Completed university level education, 28%. And the little research that's been done in Europe that I'm aware of, it supports the same point. Normally what you would get is older people, younger people are very different. University educated and people who haven't had the opportunity for that education, very different. And what's so striking about this is only in one group, in one demographic, those who are going to vote Greens, do you get outside that anywhere near. Even like if, on many issues, if you're non-English speaking background, migrant, and I ask you about multiculturalism, I ask you about cultural maintenance, what do you think? You're going to be way different from the rest of the population. You're going to be a great advocate of, you know, SBS and cultural maintenance and government funding, especially in your first 10 or 20 years in the country. But look at this.
Overseas born of non-English speaking background, 15%.
Yeah, with other sort of data, that might be 40%, but it's 15%. Why? Because these people, some of these notions, which are not untrue, it's people's experience. I've been trying to get my cousin, I've been trying to get my mother, I've been trying to get my sister into this country for the last 15 years. I'm getting nowhere. So what happens is it's complex and it speaks to people's experience, and people's experiences favourable in one sense, very harsh in another. So you know, my key points: is the problem ignorance? Is it media? Is it the way that the politicians are driving the debate? And I would say no. Rather, we have to understand people's values, political context, and complexity. You know, and the sort of things that I'm looking at is that you need to understand, for most people in our society, or very large numbers, life is a struggle. Life is a struggle. There are limits to what in their belief systems governments can do and governments shouldn't be doing. One of the characteristics of Australia is that Australia is one of only two countries in the world where you get majority support for immigration. Anyone guess what the other country is?
Canada.
Great. Australia and Canada. In England today, 80% of the people oppose immigration. And one of the things that has caused huge problems within the EU is lack of border controls. It's a good idea. But, you know, people, you know, it's truths and myths and the way they reinforce each other, and the country's been swamped and so on. These are sort of the notions that exist. Now, in Australia, as my interpretation could be wrong, in Australia, as governments have again created the image, and it's pretty substantial that they've got tight border controls, so again, the heat has gone out of the debate about immigration. Because, you know, why? What has one got to do with the other? Because a lot of people think that you know, half the immigrants are coming on boats. You know, it's less than 5% at peak. Doesn't matter. It's perceptions, and how are you going to change those perceptions? You're not going to go and educate people. There's a methodology called deliberative polling, where you lock people up for 3 days and you talk to them, and you survey them at the beginning, yeah, and then after 3 days you survey them, and lo and behold, they change their views. Amazing. But hey, listen, that's not the real world. You can't do that in the real world. That's not how the real world operates. And just, you know, the complexities, you know, that they're not queue jumpers. We know that they're not queue jumpers. But in a way, they are. Do you understand that? In people's perceptions, in a way, they are. Because what governments are always doing is they're setting queues. There's lots of queues I would like to get into, but I can't get into them. I'm sure there's many queues you'd like to get into and you can't get into it. So in a way, to say that there's no queues in Afghanistan for people to get into, it doesn't wash. Yeah. So it's that complexity. And I think we make a mistake if we reduce that complexity to simple shibboleths, like it's the media, it's the politicians, it's the drive to the bottom. You know? To try to better understand what drives and where there's room to move. And basically, where I would say that there's room to move is, and this will be my last point, and I'll stop here, is to try and push up at that 13,750 intake to 15,000, 16,000 to 17,000, and to understand that in terms of resettlement, Australia's close to being number one in the world. Australia doesn't do a shocking job. Go around and tell people you're a pack of racists. Well, okay. You made your point, but you're going to further the cause by doing that. Where is there room to move, and where there isn't room to move? You know, and unfortunately, this is horrendous, horrendous, horrendous calculus. And what the horrendous calculus says is, there's only one way that you can actually stop people getting on boats and coming to Australia. And that is if you make the conditions worse than they were before they came. Yeah. And how bad are the things, you know, in Afghanistan? How bad are the things in camps in Pakistan? What is the level of desperation? But at the end of the day, that is the true calculus. And at one level, we have to fight against that, and we have to expose that, and we have to expose the barbarity, locking children up and destroying their lives. We have to be doing that. But on the other hand, and this, I think, is what my takeaway message, but it's not necessarily going to be your takeaway message, is you work within the possibility. If you want to bring about change, understand what actually is at the basis of those attitudes and what are the prospects of achieving something, which is not to say that you must stop advocating.